Hi, my name is David Zucker, and I'd like to welcome all of you to the weekly meeting of the College of Complexes, playground for people who think. All right, we have two policies here. First, one rule at a time. Second, no personal attacks. Acquaint you with some of our policies here. A $3 tuition charge that we collected from each of you. Second, this restaurant does not exist for itself. So that means that we have to make some money off of us in order to eat here.
Hello, can you get that other microphone to point out? Yeah.
Silver one.
Yeah, that works, but it needs to be pointed out. Yeah.
For us to be here. All right.
Good.
Go ahead. Just
us to meet here. So second, and so next of all, you are encouraged to order dinner or something else to eat or drink. All right. Our format is as follows. We're going to start off with announcements. Charlie Paidock will first announce the upcoming programs. And then after Charlie gets done, we will open the floor for any other community announcements in the neighborhood or community interest. We will want no speeches during that time, just announcements. And I will introduce tonight's speaker.
Okay, guys, call it down, please. We're on air.
I will introduce tonight's speaker. We'll talk for about an hour or so on the topic. Then he will entertain the questions, which must be in that form. This is like Jeopardy. There are no speeches during that time. And after that, we will have our infamous rebuttal period, where Tim will portion out the time per person. And when we refer to a public speaker, you can talk about whatever topic you want to during a lot of time. After that, the speaker will get the last word. And then after that, we will close things down about 7:45. At about 7:45, so that the restaurant could close at 8:00. All right, Charlie, you want to start the announcements?
All right. Welcome, everyone, to meeting number 3,713. The College of Complexes, the playground for people who think. Okay, first of all, as usual, we do have a Google email group as well as a Meetup email group. And there are instructions at the top center of our website, which I think will be brought up shortly. Enable you to sign up in a few minutes to either one of those. There's not any traffic except one or two announcements of upcoming programs at the College of Complexes. As usual, I must request for myself as well as any other speaker to please put a red X on your microphone. If you are attending by Zoom, if you are in the audience, please contain your conversations at least during the presentation period. Thank you for your cooperation in this regard. Now, although I am not a capitalist, I will give an advertisement for our upcoming programs on April the 29th, our own Tim Bulger will be talking about artificial intelligence, computers. Are they becoming self-aware? AI, hot topic right now. I've looked at some of this stuff that's out there and it's singularly amazing. Anyhow, a very, very timely topic and discussion of what's going on in the state of the art. Transitioning into May. We've scheduled a special May Day speaker who is celebrating. He says May Day is his favorite holiday. He grew up within a communist household and was active in the civil rights movement. So Fred should be a fascinating speaker and ensuing discussion. on May 13th. We're getting a visitor from our satellite campus. Marilyn, I've sat through this lecture. It's very, very good. And she's talked about many facets of what she terms economic democracy. That's what we need in the United States, economic democracy, that's for sure. On May the 20th, he's there this evening, our own Jonathan Martin. He wants to incarcerate all sorts of public officials. And he says they are guilty of war crimes. He's gonna have a tribunal, I guess, and arrest all the bad guys. Good luck, John. All right, on May the 27th, another regular, Mike Lee, is going to talk about high-speed trains based on his recent trip to France and England. He took the tunnel through London and so forth. So it's high-speed rail. That leaves four dates open in June if you'd like to speak to the college or the complexes. I'd like one last mention. We do have two archival sites, one of which, of course, is our lecture library of recordings of presentations. And the other one is relatively new. It includes links to films that are free and all our PowerPoint slide presentations from recent presentations are there, including the one that I am about to use. So if you want to look at the PowerPoint slides, because we'll move through them quickly, it is there for you to click on anytime at your convenience. Thank you, Tim, take it away.
Okay, announce the speaker, Dave.
Any more announcements?
Yes.
Go ahead, get up front and we'll get you on camera.
You don't need me on camera.
No, you want to get up front, so.
Oh, you're working. In case people did not know, the Chicago Public Library has free supplies Narcan, and they also have COVID-19 test strips. And I think they also may have fentanyl test strips as well. Also, the Albany Park Library has a seed library in it, and so does the Sulzer Regional Library on Lincoln Avenue. So if you're into gardening, you can get free seeds and drop off free seeds.
Anybody else?
Thank you.
Okay.
Tim, we need to screen share, please.
What?
I have one more.
Screen share.
What, Charlie?
Oh, I got it.
All right, I have one more announcement before we get started. And then it's all cell phones should be turned off or silenced. And now, our featured speaker of the evening, you all know Charlie Paidock. The coordinator of the college for many years, and books all our speakers and the frequent speaker himself. And he's going to talk about Chuck's Echo Plan for automobiles.
That's next week. It's all right. Okay, Charlie, take it away.
All right, would you give it up for Charlie Paidock?
Okay.
Charlie. All right. We got a lot of slides to get to. Tim, will you let me know when we're about halfway through? Okay, on the hour. This is my eco plan. I'm reconfiguring the use of cars. And my primary goal is to achieve equity among the travel modes. Okay. There is a way to fix this. This is an untenable situation. We can obviously come up with some means or methods so that it does not happen. Traffic jams, common occurrence across the nation. These are my credentials. I'm co-director of Citizens Taking Action and have been for a long time, many decades. Regularly testify at all three transit boards and the RTA each year, give testimony regarding the budget and the current status of public transit. I'm also the executive director of the New York Chicago Railroad Project, High Speed Rail, and secretary of the Chicago Greens. This is the previous lecture that I gave. As I stated, this is available for viewing in the PowerPoint collection. So it's just a fun one. As a matter of fact, it was probably the first PowerPoint I ever did many, many years ago. Well, getting back to travel, we are doing an awful lot of driving in the world. In about a year or two, we travel enough by automobile that we could reach the nearest star in the galaxy, Alpha Centauri. So it's the light years is just in light years of travel using the automobile. Now, there recently, there was fascinating that was that the during the COVID, for the first time, there were terms among the transit people. They called it a transit recovery program, and we saw what the possibilities to repair the damage from the damage of a century of cars. This was our post during the band lockdown. One of them. There's another one. And see what happened. Look, it's very easy for all of you to understand. You see no cars on the right, and you see a beautiful clear sky with beautiful day. Isn't that what we all want? Isn't that what we want? Okay. Now, bringing it back home to Chicago, what are we talking about here? We got 4,000 miles of streets plus another 1900 miles, 7 highways intersecting. We got a little over half a car per person. We got 1 million cars. And at least 5% of the people are still going to work, but the commuting time is about 6 hours for everyone. That's going to change with work at home. We'll talk about that. Here's some, I've only got 5 articles with a lot of text, so bear with me. I'll try to summarize it. What is the purpose of my concept, the eco plan? But transportation has taken the number one spot for the production of greenhouse gases. It used to be, it's not industry, but it was buildings, heating and cooling buildings were the greatest source, and transportation a few, 2 or 3 years ago surpassed that. Now, one thing I wanted to get in mind, an overall perspective there, for those of you of libertarian persuasion, is that operating a vehicle is not a right by any law. Rather, it is a privilege. So keep that in mind. And the last thing is, the one thing about this overall plan, so don't get upset, because you have freedom to go. You have freedom to go where you want, when you want, and you will no way measurably be confined or limited in that regard. Keep that in mind. Okay, we must take actions to stop climate change. This is priority number one. There's no longer any debate regarding that. Also, I heard something right there. Are you anti-car? No. The individual choice or ownership of vehicle is not infringed upon in this plan. If you wish to use a gas-guzzling SUV, there's nothing in this plan that precludes you or stops you from continuing to do so. Why you would, I have no idea, but if you want to, I guess this is not the context in which that will be dealt with. And I'll discuss that later regarding what agencies are involved. Now, the one thing, we have to set up specific actions to set up a U.S. transportation network, which we presently do not have. It's virtually what has been fascinating is that regarding current technology, for the first time, we can really tell the status of transportation at any given moment. We never really knew this before. There were some measures, but very limited, very, very limited. So since we can actually so do this to and still maintain flexibility. If now there's three pages, I'll call them fine print. I write contracts. I would say, let everyone just trust Chuck. This is not, there's nothing in here that's gonna harm or hurt you. But you gotta get what I would call an authorization if you wish a license. I prefer the term authorization for each vehicle upon usage. A ticket, if you wish. And no times, these are set up in advance so that at no times will you be encumbered or required to secure one for occupational utilitarian use. We certainly do not in any way wish to harm. I do not wish to harm. I would never want to tamper with the economy of the United States. But anyhow, in order to use a vehicle, authorization must be contained. And that authorization is dependent or relevant to, dependent upon the number of vehicles standing at that time. So there is a correlation there. They are inversely related. Another full page of print. Anyhow, you can get daily, weekly, monthly passes, so you're not encumbered in that regard. Or single use, if you're so inclined. And last of all, there are so many exceptions to the provisions for using a car that I've incorporated in this. I don't think anybody has any cause for complaint. As I said, an indication again, indicate, well, you're at thy car. I have absolutely no mileage restrictions in any way discussed in the implementation of this plan. If you have proper authorization to use the car for a certain specified period of time, go ahead. There now, the last of all, I should say there could be temporary use restrictions due to such issues as air quality, energy shortages, civil disturbances, snowstorms, or other emergency situations, such as nuclear reactors exploding or something of that nature, which they're prone to do. Here you see, I've actually put one there for everyone to see. And this is what they call network loading. It used to be in transportation about the only real data we had to deal with were census data. But here's a sample of what I call is a travel authorization in order to get in and pilot your automobile. As you can see, I issued one to myself. And you can see the information. I'm driving a sedan. I'm employed in an office. So that is basically first shift 9 to 5. No concern whatsoever if I maintain vehicle usage within that time frame. There's some other data regarding my location, type of vehicle. All of this is data regarding parking as well. It could pertain. There's the ship to connect me to the central auto people. I'm driving an electric car. Also, there's one thing that's a little bit different here. It identifies me as a U.S. government co-op employee. This exceptional service. Co-op is continuation of operation, meaning in the state of a national emergency, I am regarded as essential personnel and should not be encumbered in any way. This is kind of like the gold standard of authorization cards, and a lot of people kill to get one. But if you achieve that status, you could get one as well. Anyhow, we'll get questions about this as well. Again, there's no regulation really imposed on this. And what our goal is, that all modes of transportation should be the same. If you get on a plane, you need a ticket. You get on a bus or train, you need a ticket. And when you use a car, get a ticket, that's all. Now, multiple options are available, as I said, in advance. You could store these electronically like you do transit cards. It's not, it's existing technology. You choose is an inherent feature of this program. So they're that freedom of choice. Now, one reason we have to do this, why, Chuck, do we have to do this? To correct the disparity in appropriation and allocation of resources for transportation. This has been a standard figure many people are not aware of in terms of any dollar that's spent on transportation. Highways have always gotten 80% or more of the money, and public transit, lucky if it got, I'd say they're lucky if they got 20%. That's kind of on the high side, I think. But this is the American correction. Here's the graphic illustration of what's going on here. Current U.S. policy, appropriation, allocation of our resources. Where are we spending our money? And this is what I want to achieve. Does anybody really object to that? Now I ask you, who would object to that in having a nice scale in which transportation is shared equally among the members of the community? That's my eco plan. Okay, here's one of the things we have to look forward to. The goal is no disparate treatment or privilege. I really don't like privilege, but among all of everyone's a passenger, regardless of the mode. And all passengers are the same. And we should bring it in the social stratification. I can find no argument for continuing or fostering social stratification. If you have one, please let me know. I would like to hear it. Okay. Another thing is, if there are any costs attendant to this, I said there's no charges in initial setup and getting your card for occupational use of the vehicle. Also, if there are any, now for many, many years, I negotiated this, any commuting costs that I had as an employee were borne by the employer. We're letting them off the hooks. He needs a workforce. In order to get there, it's going to involve transportation. It's a cost of doing business, not a cost of having employment. Having employment is being a good citizen. And I don't know why you should be penalized. He's getting a lot of profits, keeping most of them already. And so this is really a fractional amount, but it's a regressive tax on the poor as well, particularly those in the lower pay scale. Why do we have to do it? 2030. Read the Earth Bill stuff. Everybody and their brother is saying, we ain't got much time left, boys and girls. They've got to do something today. No more talking about this or dismissing or just dealing with this information. Another goal of this, and I think is one that should be looked at very seriously, as we have certain countries and others have nationalized industry. This is the one we really should. Nationalized transportation. No mode of transportation has ever existed without some measure or degree of government involvement. I'll repeat that. No mode of transportation has ever been in effect without some measure or degree of government involvement, some more, some less. But you can see here, there was a case. She spoke at the Calgary Lions, wrote an article for In These Times, Chicago publication, on the case for nationalizing railroads. Probably a good idea, given the uncertainties of the management of the railroad industry and their, I would say, mistreatment of the employees comprising the staffs. Now, a critical element of nationalizing transportation is the automobile. And with your support, with the good support of every good American, this can be done. I ask you, are you a good American? Then you're with Chuck. Here's some little thing. Yeah, this was in the news today. That's why another thing about nationalizing the Greyhound bus company is actually going to close their terminal in Chicago. they will not have any anywhere. You have to wait for a bus, inner city bus, on a sidewalk, which is incredible in the middle of winter. But as you see there on the left, those are my summation of this thing. They listen to me. They don't care. 400,000 passengers. These are usually low-income people. They don't care. Who cares if they have a little discomfort, right? So what? Okay, they got to take our bus. So anyhow, corporate travel providers have always been problematic. Anybody who studied the history of transportation knows that. Cars, I should remind you, are entirely a private transit node. At least the way we're thinking, our thinking is right now, which I want to change. One or another reason, we've got to look at the automobile, look down the chart, and where do you find the car? Near the bottom. The only one that is worse than a car are airlines, which I should not, actually, I think airlines should not be allowed to operate at all. There's nothing worse than an airline for particulate pollution. Every airplane sends out more particulate matter pollution than all the leaves, each airplane, than all the leaves of grass on Earth. And way they consume fuel. Oh my God, it's just incredible. Anyhow, that's another reason why. Another thing we have to do, and this encounters anyone who owns a car, that's why I said, this has applicability. Everyone wants a car. The hours wasted just sitting in a car last year. The average was 155 hours, just sitting there going no place. Why don't you go outside, sit in your car if you own one, and sit around for 100 hours? Just sit in it. That's what you're doing. And by the way, any alleged solution, all we have to do is do a little, another highway or lane there. It has never worked anywhere. Adding another lane, more lanes, has never worked anywhere to permanently alleviate congestion. And by congestion, it is getting worse. And if you want to accept it as the new normal, hey, I got no problem. You don't have to adopt Chuck's plan. But we need to make infrastructure, even they've tried infrastructure, things like express lanes, traffic light timing, variable speed limits, these as well have not succeeded in eliminating congestion. I've seen those tried in various places, like traffic light system. They tried to do that in Pittsburgh quite a bit. Traffic control. Now here's some stated term of art. We talk about traffic flow. You want to achieve maximum traffic flow. And what we talk about are headways. Headway is the distance between two vehicles of any kind. So you want to maintain a certain headway. Once the headways get too close, you have some problems. Now, headway isn't a problem, actually, on things like commuter trains. I was waiting for train. I got into Philly. I was waiting for a commuter train. And they were coming through the station. I didn't have anything to do. And I was measuring the time between trains. And it was 5 minutes or less between trains. They have good transit in Philly. They always have, Pennsylvania Railroad and all that. Less than 5 minutes. I said, wow. And they're one train after another, different trains, boarding up, just enough time to board up and scoot on out of there. That's pretty tight and running, but efficient. That's what we want now. That's what I mean. You can do that with the trains, but cars, you get too many vehicles together. Well, we got a graph on that. Another thing, consequence of congestion, it's an unpleasant topic, road rage. This is a particular problem in states of Texas and Florida with a high gun ownership. So if you are against gun control, you should take up Chuck's plan. But it is getting serious. All right. Another thing, the way the plan now, this is an old map of the transit cab companies used. They didn't have meters in Washington. And you can see there's zones one, there's a circle, the second circle is two, zones three, and zones four. So the usage or cost and so forth could be based upon how many zones you use, just as they used it to compute transit fare for years and years and years. Metra uses a zone system. I can't read this, but you can see how it works. If you stay within your zone, like this is all the government buildings, there's no issue at all. If you stay within your zone, that's what I mean, there are exceptions. If you start traveling all over town, hey, that's a different matter. Another reason we've got to do something regarding finances, and this is talked about, infrastructure bill. I had maintained a website on this. And one third of the US roads are in need of repair. We've got to do something regarding adequate revenue stream to get these back into state of good repair. It's called Maintenance of Way. There's an organization, I believe we had them at the college, the NIB, National Infrastructure Bank. They want to set up and at the same time, create jobs, trades and crafts. So you could check out their website. Another thing we got to look at regarding the automobile, when you assess the transit mode, is the condition of the fleet. Now, maybe we got to look at cars themselves. As in, you know, some people, how many modes of transit do you have? Is the car your exclusive mode, depending on where you live, or your lifestyle, or your occupation? Some of the things about cars to consider, you want to spend $48,000 for one, the fleet of them already exceed their expectant lifestyle by 4 years. They're 8 years and they're already at 12. Also, there's fraudulent activity in securing one. That's why I say there's Illinois state legislation. But there's a problem there regarding the fleet itself. Another question, I always look at an automobile. You look at what I look at, but you do not see what I see. When I see an automobile, I ask myself, how much energy was used to create that? How much energy was used? It's unbelievable. And look at that, all of those different systems. building 8.8 million of them every year. Another issue that we've got to look at for my plan is the number of household vehicles, that are necessary for nuclear and extended families. This obviously they would like to have this cut back. Another issue I won't get into, it's discussed a lot elsewhere. Dan was talking about the loss of farmland. We're losing farmland. Did I ask how much farmland was lost to the interstate highway system that could be growing food to feed the people of the nation? And what have we got for it? What have we got for all the valuable farmland with silty loam soil, the finest farmland on earth is in this nation, and to cover it up with concrete is just incredible to me. Just incredible. All right, another thing, you're in a restaurant. Here's a new topic. One of the things, you like cars? Well, you gotta have parking, right? There we are in a restaurant. You need twice as much space for the parking lot as you do for the restaurant itself. And we are spending, people don't believe this, one third of the time. Okay, you're now, I tell you, you're spending a lot of time just sitting going nowhere. You're spending one third of the time looking for a parking spot. Happy motoring. Also, the other thing about parking, that very often causes problems, double parking, waiting. Building codes, they are requiring two spaces per unit. I don't believe that's being applied in Chicago. I was looking at some new units, and they don't come anywhere close to that. This is what you get with a parking lot. The most anti-ecologically location that you could find. Look at this. No plants, no nothing. Is this what you want? Is this your idea of the world you want? Oh, now they try to come up with solutions. Parking, oh, they don't have room for parking lots. Parking elevator. All right, please silence yourself, Mike. Put a red X, Mike. Thank you. Okay, just to educate you about parking. There are seven different types of parking spaces. I like this one, tandem. They're even having to do this in some places where you share your parking space with somebody. Now, maybe a husband and wife. It could be your neighbor, you. It is a problem. My tenant was telling me he was driving home late at night from work, and he was saying how it was difficult for him. Now, let's live in a real standard neighborhood. How difficult it was to find a spot to park. I said, that's amazing. But now there's another thing. For every car that we manufacture, we're gonna need seven different kinds of spaces that are required for that vehicle. You can see there's gonna be one of those necessary. So it's a feature of it. Also, everybody in Chicago knows about this practice, claiming territorial imperative of spots. They're even making chairs now that you can put out there. This was an automatic meeting, April 19th. You can see it's still a problem within the city. They want, I would love to have been at this meeting. Here's the transit system in Chicago. And that's what I mean, there are ways to eliminate congestion. Now there are parking facilities where you see the blue squares, and that's the CTA rapid transit lines. And you can see there also are parking lots internally at various locations. This is my line right here, and right where I catch the bus train, there is a parking lot for parking vehicles. So they incorporate them as well. Some people, if this lot is crowded, or let's say you want to continue driving, it's not too badly congested, you can and park even closer in to downtown. Is often. I just came across this. Las Vegas even is beginning a charge for parking. Not at extreme ends of their parking lot, but closer in. Also, Las Vegas is kind of cool because they have an operating monorail. It's really kind of nifty. Fun little vehicle to go on. Other solutions that perhaps conceivably always talked about, these are never implemented, are some sort of strange little urban vehicles. I like this little one here. Here's a chart. You might want to look at this. Another thing of thinking about cars, what type of vehicles do you want to place or encourage or foster? Light rail? You can put so many people on light rail. You just had another car. Cars are of different sizes. The subway cars in New York in some locations are just incredibly long to me. They're like 12 cars. But they have the platforms that they can do that. It's just incredibly. We're talking a subway train. They're not fooling around. I'd like Chicago, where you find maybe two or four car trains. Another thing, light rails coming in. We got a few on that. Instead of parking garage or highway, you've got this lawn. It's good for drainage, reduces flooding. You'd rather have an asphalt nation. By the way, cities, it's been ascertained, I was reading, how cities are 15 degrees hotter as a result of all this concrete at night. 15 degrees hotter. You've got to run your air conditioner to cool that. Here's light rail project. There's about 35 of them at least I looked at for brand new or expansions across the country. There's our old streetcars. Now they're modernized. What happened in the 30s, all the transit systems standardized. They agreed on one type of streetcar, light rail vehicle. Used all over the country, the same thing, only the colors were different. These last 100 years or more, they weren't really taken out of service. They were generally sold to other countries in Europe, Central and South America, and some of them are still running today. You can ride them in San Francisco. They operate a fleet of them. This movie is in the that archive that I talked about. It's a fun video, talks about the history of streetcars in the one remaining city in the world, for that matter, where you really find them in operation is Toronto, Canada. Another thing we've gotten rid of, perhaps we ought to reconsider, is the interurban network. These are slightly, let's say, heavyweight cars that travel basically in rural areas between small towns, offering an alternative to the automobile. Those in rural areas, I would be arguing for this. Illinois had one in central Illinois. It was quite an operation. They have a restored car here in Chicago at the Rail Museum. This is how light rail looks today. This is in China. And you can see they don't use rails anymore. The guiding is in the concrete, in the thing. So you don't have rail maintenance or any feature in that regard. Here you can see another city. This reminds me of Denver. It has a street like this downtown. It's very nice. This is Europe, I believe. This is really nice. Want to go, what's nice. Another thing, I'm not really anti-car, but those of you who like to have your coffee in the morning, you can sit and wait in line, get in your car, and this is what you want. This is what you want. Wait in line for your double latte, or you could sit, let's say, talk to some pretty girl, you know, what's going on. Another thing we got to look at, perhaps, another problem actually that is caused by cars is that they're basic. No one solved this problem, but they're single occupant operator. Now, maybe if we have some sort of charge or something, an authorization for cars, you might want to save up your chores or do things together, some incentive at least. I've never seen anything to. The average is only 1.5 person's car most of the time. People are all by himself. This three general things I came across. Is this what you want? A 50-lane traffic jam in China. Oh, we don't have to do anything. Oh, I like this. They're putting a highway. Oh, get rid of that beach. It needs a beach, man. And you can have a road. Yeah, I like this. This is Texas. This is the United States. Prize winning. 26 lanes. Look at this. I posted all this picture. I said, that's unbelievable. Look at, I'd love to see how this happened. There should be a book written about it. Oh, they're out. How in the world did they arrive at? Look at this. And he's like, is this a transit solution or the world's greatest mistake? All right. Getting back to serious matters, what we're trying to achieve in Chuck's plan is something that railroad's been doing for an awful long time. And I will use the term fleet management. They know what vehicles they have on the tracks. They use a block system, just like you have blocks in cities. Only one vehicle per block. In order to enter a block, okay, the dispatcher that the one that was in it before has left. So it's one block at a time. Railroads have extensive signaling and communication systems, and they to maximum use of their traffic. Thank you. Excuse me. One of the things that enables my plan is that we now have cell tower data. These are already installed, and the infrastructure's there. And at any given time, we have real-time, real information on what traffic is going on. Buses have always had some sort of measuring devices. This is one that you can find on CTA. There's a little light when you get on, when you get off. They can tell what people are. Are they going a full trip, or are they mid-trip travel, a mid-route travel? This is a lot. Another thing, I mentioned data. This is coming up, a University of Illinois Urban Forum. It says here we got an awful lot of data. What are we going to do with it? We've got information about cities that we didn't have before, and let's put it to some use to solve some problems. Check that out. I'll get you more if you want. Another thing about what we really want to achieve is integrated transportation. Integrated is a fancy term for different, using different travel modes, or going from one mode to another. Oh, here's the thing. Now, jam is what we've got to get rid of. The feature of the jam, we get too many vehicles, basically always caused by too many railroad blocks. This is also, we've got information coming in. Everybody knows this. Anybody using CTA, you got these things right at the entrance to see many CTA stations. It tells you the precise up to the moment status of that transportation network. We also need some system for better action and response to unforeseen conditions, such as accidents, fires, what have you. Another reason in general to diminish car usage in any way, shape, or form is that it is a hazardous mode of travel. I'm sorry, folks, it is. And something has got to be done about that. Why it's persisted, I have no idea. What goes on? Another thing, you've heard adoption of this plan is it failed. It didn't work. It just didn't work. Here you can see meters, steep different light stop light schedules, toll booth, cameras, speed cameras. None of them work. Traffic and for none of it. Here's the thing: you can compare the misguided concept that you think you got solution. No solution at all. No new solution at all. This is a fun one. The guys wanted to add this, where if you got fed up with traffic, you could just drive off and abandon your car. And they'd have someone watch it so you could get out of train then. It's get fed up. I talked about inner parking lots by train. This is one where you just had it. Pull off, and I'm not going to get there anywhere, so I might as well move on. What are the costs, let's say, of an authorization? The things to consider is that current transit fare, we call it revenue per mile. How much revenue per mile will your system generate, in transit at least? And current rates are, it costs you about 65.5 cents, I believe, to operate an automobile per mile. That's what employers are compensating people if they use their own call for work related things. You don't have to go through all this. This is the economics of an automobile, insurance, gasoline, but we're spending more per cars than you are for food. That's just incredible. Another thing to consider is the possibility of free public transit. In lieu of an automobile, we get sufficient revenue. We couldn't achieve this. They do it in Kansas City, and they do it in all these cities around the world. We're almost there. Another thing to consider, you say, I got to get an authorization card. What is the actual cost of using your car, which you use 10 hours and 50 minutes per week. What is the actual cost? You got $10,000 invested or more. $48,000 is parked sitting there. Like, yeah, the cost of these things is per usage. It's like a book in a library. A book in a library that is checked out all the time. Actually, the way you can really think about it, doesn't cost very much. But a book that you buy and put on the shelf and no one borrows it is very expensive. 90% of the vehicles, by the way, sit there and don't do anything. We spend about $25 a day. Can you imagine this woman if she had that money to make dinner for her family? Another thing is there's been many fluctuation in the workforce. Work at home is now a thing that used to be, believe you me, I have pioneered this. I had to go to court to get this in contracts. All kinds of alternate work schedules. When I worked, I could come to work anytime between 7 and 9. Anytime was fine. This is why for one day off every 2 weeks, one day off every week. But now they call it hoteling. Nobody has a desk. There's going to be problems because people are going to stay home on Monday and Fridays now with work at home and come to work only Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. So there's going to be a bubble. Another thing, of course, always talk about is to get rid of petroleum dependency. We're spending about $1.18 U.S. tax and 78 cents Illinois, the tax on gas. One of the unique features of Chuck's plan is that it localizes revenue. There is always some issue that say, well, I live in a small town in a rural area. Why would I pay for public transit? Why would I want my tax money going for public transit in a big city? But using Chuck's plan, the revenue is generated locally and it's used locally. So that silences any criticism in that regard. Well thought out, Chuck. Okay, as I said, we'll probably generate more than enough revenue to enable free public transit, which will foster people using it. You're going to see that if it's free, they're going to start transitioning out of the auto. One of the things that somewhat bothers me is that I don't like privilege. And rich people don't really care. They're probably willing to pay whatever. But I think we could probably possibly put a cap on automobile usage, at least to preclude disproportionate, disparate use. Who wants to return to these days? This is an insult. Look at this poor guy. Look at this rich guy. He wanted this photo in his car because he's a big shot. He wanted to show everyone. He didn't do any work. Another thing I mentioned is this plan only involves the U.S. Department of Transportation and IDOT. It does not involve Department of Energy, Department of Commerce, EPA, you're talking about pollution controls, whatever. No, it focuses on a very specific area, and that's transportation. You can bring those in. They have no relevance to what we're talking about now. All that stuff, oil usage, those are handled by other agencies, infrastructure, things like that. No infrastructure required. Ready to go? Let's do it. Another feature in this, under no circumstances, I believe, if you're a primary caregiver, that should there be any restrictions in any fashion if you want to go visit grandma. That's what we're supposed to do as a society, is care for one another. Here you see this nice young lady visiting an older person. This is what we want. And this will be encouraged. If you can visit them with no problem, you're more likely to do so. So see the positive effects. I've made everybody feel a little better, the seniors at least, right? They get a better relationship. Another thing, that versus cars, transit systems like Chicago, they have prisoners and they transition them into the workforce. So if you're incarcerated in prison, CTA will has a special program to get you in the workforce. We've got again to get rid of the CO2s. There's no discussion of this. We've got to reduce greenhouse gases, and we want to get revenue. We need revenue. You may complain about public transit. Well, let's get the revenue to improve it and expand it. Again, with revenue, we can improve and expand public transit to have it the way we want. This is just a cartoon. A guy complaining about why public transit is subsidized when in fact the automobile is what we are subsidizing in so many different ways. Now, the one thing I should add for this discussion is what do we need in a transportation like public transit are what we call performance measures. And the number one that people want, it's got to be dependable. They don't care if it's dangerous, dirty, anything else, but they want, when it says a train is, or bus is due, they want that bus there. So it's got to be dependable. Again, easily achievable with the revenue stream. But public transit also fosters the economy. Plenty of things are written about transit-oriented development. Okay, almost done. This is one of my big things put on social media. The future of cars is electric, but our future is not cars. I did a talk on UFOs. I guess I believe the aliens are testing out a weapon system. There were all kinds of reports about a blue lights on cars when the engines would shut off. I believe they're testing weaponry prior to an invasion. That's my take on this. Another thing you might want to think about having good travel and transportation is that if people want to put up thorium reactors, you sure as hell better have one. All right, we want to turn our towns. We had a speaker many years ago, and we haven't really had any movement towards this. We want our neighborhoods and towns to be eco-villes. Have you done anything to transform your neighborhood into an eco-ville? I try to change mine all the time. This is one way to do it. In suburbs, they have, this one place is doing this already. They have these autonomous vehicles, goes around, picks up people, takes them to the train station. First mile, last mile, provided by the suburb. And we had a speaker on this Autorama. The Auto Boys will tell you all kinds of things at the auto show. We listen to the propaganda. I refuse to go, but oh yeah, you're gonna have all this kind of, just get in, see the USA in your Chevrolet. That's all, get in here and it'll let you know when you're in San Francisco. One way I just wanted to throw this in, please do assess your transit system. This is important. And the figures I use, more important than any other. How many train stations are there? How many bus stops? This is crucial. How many bus stops are there? What are the routes? What are the schedules? And most importantly, how many revenue hours do they operate? How many miles, revenue miles, are in the system? Look at those figures, save you a lot of time. Here's one, just one idea, improving library in bus stops so you can get a book while you're waiting. Bicycles, I'm sorry, I cannot. I know there's some enthusiasts there. I believe they are still some issues there regarding safety, and they're not suitable for various reasons. I've been to programs of the Chicago Bicycle Federation, which are enthusiasts entirely, but I'm sorry, I cannot advocate this as a parody of a transportation mode. Though other people will argue differently, I personally don't think so. Just one more thing that I know about public transit on the transit side of citizens taking action. You've got links to the transit systems in the area, the RTA budget. You can see their breakdown. If you want to study transportation, there are three colleges in Chicago in which you can major in it. By the way, the Earth Bill, which I'm promoting, spends one third of the Earth Bill is dedicated to legislation regarding transportation. This is where the United States is currently spending its money on transportation. This classified document, which somebody leaked. Last of all, everybody ask yourself, now having you were done, so relax, but having viewed the presentation, will everyone please indicate either an email or let me know your choice. Number one, I like Chuck's plan, count me in, or I'm a little busy right now and I don't care what happens to the planet. So let me know, maybe later on during the presentation or by email, which you choose, if you're A or B. And there we go. Thank you again for coming and let her rip. Tim?
Hello, is anybody speaking?
All right. Questions? Who's the moderator?
I'll moderate. Enrique, how can I go ahead?
Who's moderating? Is this Justin?
Yeah. Or maybe Karina wants to moderate? I don't know. She's up at the podium at the restaurant.
Oh, okay.
But she's silenced. She's silenced.
No, I just want to make sure that I have my time to ask the question as per the rules.
I will moderate, though, in Tim's stead, since
go ahead and
hear the restaurant.
Okay. Charlie, I have a ton of stuff to say about your plan and practically none of it good, but we'll leave it at that for now. But I just have one question for you in the question and answer. I'll get to more of it in the rebuttal phase. How do you plan on getting this plan of yours through Congress and forcing it down the American people's throats, who will rebel if you even attempt to go anywhere near the extent that you're trying to push it? How do you attempt to implement this plan?
I've had many, many years experience in Congress. And yeah, something has to be done. I gave you so many reasons that people are spending a lot of money and not getting anywhere. Who wants that? I have to argue that? Go ahead. Don't have the plan. Sit in your car, burn damp, I guess, and sit in the spot. That's your choice, sir.
How do you plan to get this passed?
You don't go anywhere. You don't get anywhere. You just burn gas.
How do you plan to get this passed?
Let's do nothing. I know what. Let's do nothing. You're sitting in the car 10 hours a week. Well, let's make it 12. How about 15, Enrique? The times are increasing.
How do you plan to get this plan passed, is what I'm asking.
What do you mean? It's of everyone. It's transportation. Everyone uses transportation.
You think Congress is going to pass this horrible plan of yours?
Absolutely they will.
They didn't pass it before. They're not going to pass it now.
It has never been introduced. Thanks for the question, Enrique.
Never been introduced. Nonsense. Okay. This is brand new. How
all right.
Come up with that. if it didn't pass before. Where is
he? I'll catch you in the rebuttal. I'll catch you in the rebuttal.
Yeah.
Go
ahead, Calvin.
It's more likely to happen on a local level than it is happening on a national level.
Exactly. I don't know what he's talking about.
It's congestion problems in its own way. You will find a lot of cities have fines if it's single occupant vehicle is on certain roads in the city. You will have congestion charges in places like London.
We're starting to have congestion problems here because people can't follow the rules with the moderator.
You're not going to object that much if your city says, well, we're going to build a metro system. We need to get into town and out.
But I think these guys will just have to be one fool at a time. I'll take the questions like we normally do.
Nobody was moderating. Nobody. What'd you do, go for a walk?
Calvin was getting ready to ask his question, wasn't he?
Well, the thing is that we got people here too waiting. So Karina's next, then we'll go to an
end. Oh, Calvin started already.
Well, we already went to Karina, but we couldn't, it was muted.
To be fair, I was just answering the question you gave to Charlie, to be fair.
Okay, now we're going to go to Karina next, and I'll let you know who's next in line.
Because you didn't operate the thing properly, it's our fault.
Charlie, you know.
You blame us.
You're wasting our time, Charlie.
Yeah, hey, no personal attacks, guys. One full at a time.
Let's get back to the question. With a red X. That makes sense.
Charlie, you had mentioned an issue, a very specific issue, and that was at our Union Station and the closing of a bus terminal that is used by a lot of people. Is there any specific, have you contacted the Active Transportation Alliance or Center for New Technology? Is there any specific answer? Is that public property? Can Amtrak make that decision? Is there any action going on or any way to reverse that?
All right, Charlie. Unmute, Charlie. Charlie, please unmute. Okay.
Who put an X on my thing? What the hell's going on here?
You're disruptive, so just start.
Hey, don't you do that again, pal.
Well, then I'm
saying that's not going to happen again. That's not going to happen again. Got it?
I got it.
Let me answer the question and recede into the background. In answer to her question is, that is West Side Development. A lot of you know about that. It's become prime real estate, situated in pretty close in proximity, University of Illinois, and the central is, oh, it's really centrally located. They're nice, also pretty well, but no, there's nothing. And actually, I don't look to those groups you mentioned. The one, I never having done anything. I'm sorry, but it's private property and it's been sold from what I understand already. It's a done deal.
All right, who's next? All right, Jonathan, go ahead.
Thank you, Charles Paidock, for telling us why cars need to go.
They need to be improved.
Logistically build an east-west, north-south national bike grid in the U.S. so that people 100% through green energy transportation can go all the way from one coast to the other or one northern border to the southern border of the United States.
I didn't hear it. What do you want? Could you repeat it? What is the question?
Can we logistically build an east-west, north-south national bike grid in the United States?
We already have one.
Green energy transportation in the warm season for warm-blooded Americans who like to just bike.
We already have one. I lived on the Lincoln Highway, and I had any number of people pass my house. I lived on the Lincoln Highway, and they come through. I even had some stay overnight in my pad. I lived I didn't live in the town. I lived in a rural area and they came through. I'm sorry. Bicycling is, you saw it. It's a hazardous mode of travel. I would say it's possibly, I can't even recommend trail riding. I'm a hiker. I don't know why you need to ride up and down a trail. Walk across the United States. It's nice. Yeah, what's hurry? You're in a hurry?
Quick, Charlie, and ask a European participant tonight's free speech forum, is it possible to go from one end of the country where you happen to live on planet Earth to another just using a bike in the season?
You can already go. You can already use your bike to go across the country. I told you, I knew people. I met dozens of people who were doing it. They can do it already.
All right. I would like to correct this statement.
If this guy thinks we're going to suddenly find an extra lane of highway someplace, I don't know why that happens. You just find an extra lane of highway across the United States. Yeah, let's take up more of farmland. Let's take, Dan was talking last week how we need farmland. So we just heard a guy that says he wants to take farmland in some fashion across the entire nation. It may be a long strip, but it's acres and acres. And the infrastructure adjacent to highways, you have to move all that. And you got to think about this stuff. It's unforeseen conditions. You'd have to move all the stoplights in the United States. Come on. All right. You ready, Ernie?
Yeah. Yeah, I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Very
yeah.
Good.
I apologize. My computer kind of crashed and I was gone for about 3 or 4 minutes, but I don't think you've been asked or answered this question. I like many aspects of your plan requiring or different acknowledging different uses of the highways and of our vehicles and essentially charging different rates for that. Although you don't talk so much about charging, nonetheless, that's what it amounts to. But here's my question. Many cities throughout the world have adopted something called congestion pricing or variations thereof, where people will pay for being in certain or driving on certain roads at certain times of the day. And why do you reject this idea? Or do you think it seems to me that some form of congestion pricing, maybe a little more sophisticated than what's in use today, is the best way to control usage? Okay, that's my first question. The second question is, how does your plan eliminate the big problem that, as you stated, 94% of the time vehicles are sitting somewhere in a parking lot and not doing anything? I'm done talking about rush hour congestion. I'm talking about parking it at night, parking it during the day while you're at work. But the main question is on congestion.
Yeah, I got it. All right. Ernie, my entire plan is a version of congestion pricing.
Okay.
From totality. You've got some rather primitive applications, which are toll gates.
Mm-hmm.
This raises it into a reasonable thing. Yeah, in Manhattan does it. London, that's a very, very initial primitive application of traffic control. But this is a live program that we're looking at the volume of traffic. And yes, there are occasions where authorizations will not feel available I don't know how often that would be, certain times of the day, times of the year, or holidays. But no, this is incredibly, he asked me, is it black? It's a very sophisticated, if you wish, application of congestion pricing.
Now, how would people get these?
I don't like that term. I don't like that term. I call it traffic management.
Yeah. Well, how would people get these authorizations? Would they go online, or would they have to send?
So you can get traffic passes now. You can go online. They were selling them in grocery stores and drug stores. You could go downtown.
Okay. So no, you'd pay money to
wait a minute, pal.
Well, explain that part of it. I didn't get that part of it.
You only get two questions.
Okay.
The second one, I believe, was that you're asking, well, if you start improving, if you have a revenue stream and you begin improving other modes, and there's a deterrent to using one, there's going to be a natural demographic flow into it. If public transit is of superior quality, people are not going to insist on having it. Why? And if vehicles that sit, you're paying for what? Nothing. For owning it. Boy, what do I benefit? Oh, I own it. There's no utility. It's got to, like I gave you the example of a book, it's got to be in use to have utilitarian use and to bring down the cost. But you're purchasing, hey, why don't you go out and buy something, a shirt, and never wear it?
I've done that. Not often, but.
Well, thank you. Now, what is all right? Let's get your other question.
All right. Are you done, Ernie?
I could actually answer.
Well, I want to get, we'll get back to this later. Let somebody else go ahead.
The logistic of getting in is not an issue. Come on. They're easily attainable. Online. Come on. Hey, we're in a modern world now.
Yeah, I know we're in a modern world, Charlie. My next question to you is, where in the heck did you come up with such a harebrained scheme?
It's a good scheme, Tim. Just needs some refinement.
Hey, you're the chair. The rules are remarks and rebuttals are at the next session. Please follow the rules.
We are following the rules. You keep violating them.
Here, I have a question.
Please follow the rules. That's all I ask.
My question is, I'm not sure when you have developed this, or you said a few years ago, or for who, but it seems to me that your plan is, it's like a tax plan would be, you know, the way you penalize people in order to achieve social goals, whereas it's almost like a communist idea without looking at.
Wait a minute. I buy a ticket, to go on CTA, that's a communist plot.
Can I finish my question? It's like a bureaucracy.
Yeah, I got it. You asked me, is it taxation?
It reminds me of like Ayn Rand, that guy.
What's your question?
You take all the people and all the choice. It really seems, it makes me.
Again, you're getting into rebuttal.
Ayn Rand world, really.
What's your question?
It gives communism a bad name, really. A bureaucrat's version of reality.
What's your question?
It's like a social credit score. A social credit score. Do I get to drive to see my mother?
What's the question?
What does visiting your mother have to do with this plan?
Twilight Zone.
That's nice that you do it. All right, an answer to it. I don't know. It's the same as buying a ticket. I do. Having a ticket to get on a bus. You can get a ticket to get on an airplane, and no one gets upset about that. So what's the big deal? This communism that you have to I like this. You have to pay transit fare. Paying fare for transportation is communism. I think it's purchasing something. It's capitalism. You guys, come on. All right, who's next?
Charlie, bureaucratic, Nick Wittery.
Charlie, not following the rules. Put a red X on that guy.
All right, who else is next?
All right, who has the next question?
He's getting one from the audience here. Go ahead. All right, he's going to get up from. Get up front. Yes. All right. All right.
After hearing Chuck's plan, I sure prefer Henry's plan.
What's Henry's plan?
Henry Ford. What's your question?
I say we need more engines, more V8s, LS, Coyotes, Hemis. More power. Go, go, go. Burn more oil. Drill, baby, drill.
Well, more and more people are finding an automobile is not in part of their lifestyle choice.
All right,
and the numbers are growing.
Okay.
I'm winning that one. More and more people every day, as we talk, decided to go without a car, and they're the young people coming in. I know that. They don't buy cars or want to have cars, and that's, I'm winning.
Mike, come on up and ask your question.
You got a question, Mike?
Then we'll go to rebuttals.
Jake, unmute him.
All right, Jake, go ahead, unmute. We'll get you next.
You got him muted, I think.
Jake.
Charlie, I got a quick question for you.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, you're nationalized the railroads. How are you going to do it? How are you going to get it through Congress?
Oh, they already were nationalized during World War I, the National Railroad Administration. And they had.
Yeah, well, that doesn't mean it's nationally owned.
Yeah, they ran at bleep top to bottom. They even had something like 6 types of steam engines. Railroads in other countries, in Germany, or in England, nationwide, it's been more, actually, it's more the rule than the exception, Jake. So it's done. As a matter of fact, the worst thing that happened in England was, I mean, the Reichsbahn in Germany was the greatest train system in the world. And in England as well, when they went, they privatized England. It was a disaster.
I'll second that.
Yeah.
Okay, but that doesn't answer the question. How are you going to get it through Congress? We have a very fragmented rail system. Parts of it are publicly owned, but a large part of it is privately owned. How are you going to nationalize it?
It's going to be demanded. The retail, the commercials are going to demand it because of the same as they had the grain demanded changes in railroad and the commercial establishments, the businessmen of the United States are going to demand it as a government provision. As I told you, all transportation is somehow government related already. Railroads began, I hate to tell you, with a government charter.
All right.
And they can bring it back to that. And I would say that the fixed rates. Now, what are you getting now? They're getting a lot of money and little or no service. They want just-in-time delivery.
All right. Mike, go ahead.
All right, Charlie.
He's there.
Are you there?
Yeah. I can see ya.
Did you put a lot of brain power in, your research? I got just a quick question. UK. Okay, so
Is this a panacea of these electric cars? Is it really the future, or are we being sold a bill of goods?
Could you repeat that? Is, I don't really care what type of vehicle they use, sir. And I don't know the technology of it. I do advocate something like trolley buses and trains, electric trains, but electric vehicles, I think you're trying to achieve something that's not suited with these giant batteries. I think you have to have a continuous source of energy and from one source, and to make it portable. You have these batteries. I think they're just, the problem of the batteries is not quite there yet.
Okay, go ahead. All right. Who's next?
Good to see you there. He's a good electric train guy.
Rebuttals. Get us to rebuttals. Dave, get us to rebuttals. All right, Dave.
Transportation should be like my Lionel train.
Jonathan's got a rebuttal. Jonathan, you got a question?
Sure, I got a question.
Then we'll, after him, we'll go to rebuttals. Go ahead.
Thank you, Charlie, again, happy Earth Day. The blue lights coming from the aliens beaming down on the sky, disabling the cars. Are those the space lasers that Marjorie Taylor Greene sometimes talks about? And if so, can they disable other things, Charlie?
Yes. Good question.
Yeah, good question.
I'm sorry, I don't keep up with that woman. I see she's in the news a good bit, but I honestly haven't. I guess she's noted for making outlandish statements. I think we've got to take this alien presence. They're obviously testing it. Listen, they got it. They're working on a wonder weapon. I was watching a documentary. They were wonder weapon.
What?
A wonder weapon.
Oh.
Okay. And this may be there to cripple. Now, whether or not it works on cars, I don't think it works on trains.
Okay, Enrique.
Jim, I have a quick question for Charlie. Very quick.
Go right ahead.
Charlie, there's approximately 330 million people in the United States of America. How many people of that 330 million do you think support this stupid harebrained idea of yours? End of question.
Go ahead, Charlie.
I'm going to proceed. If you think, wait a minute, there's a thing called speeches, Tim knows this. I took speech and there's a thing called the speech of persuasion. So yes, I go around the country and hey, all we have to do is show that it's working in Chicago and they'll be flocking here. And more will say, hey, you know, that guy, Chuck, he really, really took care of all the traffic issues. Chuck's plan worked in Chicago. Maybe we ought to take a look at it.
Chicago that's trying this calm problem.
They're all going to be here wanting to say, and we'll probably have to schedule them to take them around and show it how it works.
Okay. If there's no more, get up there and let's get the rebuttals.
Maybe we'll implement it in Washington, D.C. They have some real serious issues. They're very serious.
I'm trying to rebuttal. We
trapped it in Washington.
4 to 6 minutes. 6 minute rebuttals tonight.
Don't I get on any applause?
I'm sorry.
Let's thank our speaker, Charlie Paidock.
All right. Good presentation with harebrain.
My comment is basically on this. First, some people allege that the union station is closing. It is not. Corinne, are you listening? The union station is not closing. What's closing or rumored to close is the Greyhound bus terminal at Jefferson and Des Plaines. That's being, if that is allowed to close, it would really cause
The station is no longer owned by Greyhound. It's now owned by a private real estate operator, and they're making noises about selling it off so they can make real estate money from the sale of the station. Yeah, I agree with that. I think it should be kept open. Moving along, in regard to shutting down the nation's airlines, I agree that the airlines contribute their share of pollution, but there is no other practical between cities at this point or to get across the ocean to other countries. I don't think we're going back to travel by ship. And so pressure should be built on the aircraft manufacturers and the manufacturers of aircraft engines to find some other means of fueling the aircraft using a better means of propulsion. Already they're using more modern jets that it is the less than the older jets of the 707.
Oh, ridiculous.
I myself saw a feature film that was made in 1968, which some of the characters travel on a DC-8, go from Moscow to Rome. And I was reminded of just how much filth those older jets put out into the air. And as I said, unless you could come up with a better means of transportation, the airline's going. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, who cares about the airlines in the sky? Who cares? It's like a flying gas station.
Just leave him. He'll go from there. I think we can hear him. Yeah, go ahead. Bring it over to him. Well, let Sid go next. Okay, Sid.
Yeah. What we have to do is go by necessity. Right now, as everybody knows, the climate is changing so fast. And if you keep going like we're going, we won't have a planet to live on. So what we have to do is make everything easy as possible to get to without using a ton of fossil fuels to get there. For instance, if somebody, let's say 1,000 people work at a giant factory, their homes should be within a mile of that factory. Another thing, there should be shopping for all manner of goods in that particular area. So you don't have to use cars all over. And if you want to go, to another city, let's say, we can have notes saying that you're going here at a certain time. And if anybody else can go, they both should go together. So now what you say, and there's a lot of unnecessary things. And one of them is war production. And we send war production all over the world. And we send oil all over the world. We send fossil fuels all over the world. And there's something that should not be subsidized. If somebody wants to make money, it should be done with their own capital, not by the government. But if you have something very serious, like cancer, something like that, there should be a hospital not too far away. Also, there should be clinic not too far away so people have minor problems as far as health. They can take care of that. So there's a lot of things that could be done right now, like in your apartment your window, you know, and the summer to be sealed to some degree so you don't move the air and you have clean air, things of that nature. There's so many things that could be done, but the trouble is everybody has to make money. Everybody has to maximize the business profit. And that rhymes with having a decent environment.
Okay.
All right, Jonathan, get that. Justin, you're next if you want to rebut. Justin, go ahead. You got your hand up, rebut.
All right. So I actually share a lot of the frustration and concerns Charlie has. Not all of them, but you know, many of them. I strongly disagree with his solutions to the problem. I agree with Charlie that, you know, building, you know, more lanes and the interstate highway system kind of not only demolishing the countryside, but also the cities as well. And I just can't help but think of a lot of history that was lost due to, you know, eminent domain and taking and building, trade in quotes, trading somebody's property for roads or whatever. I think that the way to get more people, I don't think a top-down solution will work. I think this has to be a bottom-up sort of thing. And I think the best way to do that is just to raise awareness and let people know the benefits of not having a car. I personally live in Chicago, so I don't have to have a car to drive everywhere. I have everything that I have to live within walking distance, or I could take the bus or the CTA or whatever. I can even get to the suburbs fairly easily without a car. So if the state is going to be spending money for transportation infrastructure, I think moving away from cars and roads is probably the best way to go. Again, like I said, we should start from the bottom up and do awareness. So, you know, we should convince people that walkable cities and alternate modes of transportation are the way to go. You might have a very difficult time considering how much of our infrastructure is laid out in a way so people can get from the suburbs to the city easily. They can commute to work and back. And I really don't understand the logic in driving, you know, 50, 60, 70 miles round trip several times a week to your job is any productive use of your time or your car, or the fact that, you know, we have to pull our resources together to pay for these giant roads that make it possible for us to do this. So I think that and Charlie mentioned also the parking around places and how much space that takes. A lot of that is mandated by the government. So, you know, if people can just, people should just expect that they're, you know, you live in the city, there's going to be traffic and there might be limited parking. So prepare accordingly. I don't think that's in the state should make people have space for parking. And, that's just several of the ways that you know, I agree with Charlie. If we're going to have any sort of top-down approach, which I don't recommend, it should be the highest level should be at the state level. I think that the federal government should mostly get out of transit policy, let each state administer their own sort of transit policy. And if we want to keep up, say, the federal highways, you can let states get into compacts with each other to maintain those that are already existing. But I think that living in dense areas where such transportation is possible is a preferable way of living, and more people should do it. You should. And if that's not for you, hey, that's fine. Some people like living in the countryside, and that's fine, and people should be able to do that. But, you know, just be aware that there's going to be a lot of stuff out there, and the roads to get there should probably only be built to fitted to those who live there. I think that's all.
Okay, we got Jonathan's next online. Jonathan, you're next.
I think he agreed with me. He agrees with me.
All right. Just stay right where you're at, Jonathan.
How much time?
You got 4 minutes.
My goodness. We got the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Mother Earth here tonight, if you want a copy. It's got a preamble. It's got Article 1. Mother Earth is a living being. It's got Article 2, inherent rights of Mother Earth. And Article 3, obligations of human beings to Mother Earth. Some good stuff on this list. I won't read them all, but every human being is responsible for respecting and living in harmony with Mother Earth. We're all for that. No matter who you are, where you're from, we can all find common ground on that. Human beings, all states and all public and private institutions must act in accordance with the rights and obligations recognized in the Declaration. I'm sure we can all agree on that in the 21st century. Check it out, Universal Declaration of Rights of Mother Earth. I wish I had time tonight during the rebuttal to read the whole thing, because it's a beautiful document that might save us from extinction. Another thing about Charlie's interesting talk that I thought was a B-plus talk, it would have been an A talk, Chuck, if it would have talked more about bicycles. Now, I don't know why I'm so fascinated by bicycles. The majority of Americans won't even ride their bicycles in the warm season. I understand that. That's something I'm willing to concede in 2023.
But when dangerous.
In the next 10, 20, 30 years. My suggestion to my fellow not just Americans, but my fellow carbon-based life forms is, my background is when I was 11, 12, 13, 14, I lived in Northern Europe and they had bike paths everywhere there. And that was 1983, 1984, 85, 86. And in the warm season, you could take your bike on the bus, on the train, you literally 365 days a year didn't need a car at all in Northern Europe. I don't know about anywhere else and the planet. Obviously, Northern Europe is a rarely, a lot of combination of things that make it very rare. So it's possible there. I wish it was possible in the United States, and I still believe it is possible if we just have the will. Comedians are going out of business because politicians are talking about space lasers coming from the sky. I wish I had more time for that, because that's fascinating. I'm glad you brought that up, Charlie. Valuable use of our time. And I have a little story in the last minute and 10 seconds that I have. Where I live in the western suburbs of the most beautiful city on earth, Chicago, they had a bus stop there close to Roosevelt Road, and they didn't have a bench. So I thought it'd be a nice thing if I went to my local hardware store and bought a $120 bench and put it next to the bus stop. Now, I knew there'd be some challenges here. Wind. So you got to lock it down with these like garden hooks in the ground so it doesn't fly out there with the wind. So I chained those garden hooks to the bench and put it in the ground. And I was like, great, I've got a bench to sit on when I'm waiting for my bus and I need to get my fare or read my book. They took that bench away within like 2 weeks. So the next year I bought a second bench and put it next to that heavily used bus stop, and they took that bench away also. So the fossil fuel industry is playing for keeps, and they played dirty. I don't think it was just a local resident who would do that. I think it was somebody who didn't like the fact that people were using public services and liked it. I'll finish with this quote from John Lennon. We've got this gift of love, but love is like a precious plant. We can't just accept it, leave it in the cupboard, or just think it's going to get on by itself.
You got to keep on watering it. You got to really look after it and nurture it. Happy Earth Day, everybody. Get your copy of the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Mother Earth on one.
Okay, Ernie, you're next.
Ernie. Yeah, can you hear me?
I'll get you after Ernie.
Am I unmuted? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right, I got a bunch of stuff here. First of all, I think that the Chuck's plan is basically has a very strong core. It's a good core for a plan. I don't think it's a crazy scheme as some people are saying. And I don't know what their reasoning for saying that is, except that they don't want to pay any more money, or they don't want to have the government telling them what they can do, da 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 da. Well, the government tells us what we can do all the time when we're driving. If we come to a red light, the government is telling us to stop, okay? And if we don't, we get into trouble. Anyway, I like the core of the plan, but I'm not clear on a few of the things in terms of the mechanics. I don't understand. Maybe Charlie, in your final little speech, you could clarify this. Who actually owns the vehicle? Do I get to own a car if I want and just use it according to those terms? Or do I not get to own a car? Does some national agency own the car and they let me get the car when I need it? Okay. And how do we pay? We covered this a little bit, I guess, on the internet. You were saying you can apply for some of these extra needs and so forth. And I assume that you can, I don't know, pay with a credit card or however one would pay. But those mechanical things were not totally clear to me. I disagree on a few things. Being a capitalist, I admit that I'm a capitalist, at least in part of the socialist too, but in part I'm a capitalist, and the capitalist side of me disagrees with not increasing the taxes, particularly the fuel taxes. If you want to reduce usage of something, you make it cost more. And one of the basic ways to make it cost more is with taxes. Smokers won't like me saying this, because the cigarette taxes are high, but it does reduce usage a little bit here and there. Gas taxes, if gas taxes were higher, especially if they were a lot higher, people would find other ways to get from point A to point B. Now, these taxes could be different in different areas. Out in rural areas, we don't want to make it so difficult for people to move around. But here in the city, people have alternatives. And to make them use the alternatives, we'd make it very expensive. Also, your basic license fees, your city stickers and your license plates and so on, the fees could be higher. Chuck's aversion to congestion pricing. Well, actually, he claims his plan is a version of congestion pricing, and it is. But I think that the congestion pricing that actually tracks what you use would be a better system. In other words, if you drive your car during rush hour, you'd pay a per mile rate to drive your car. And if you were driving it in uncongested areas or late at night or something like that, the rate would be very low. But if you're riding it on major expressways during rush hour, or in a downtown congested area or any congested area, you'd pay more. And the rates would vary. The rates would be published. And so you would know if, for example, if you take a trip downtown to do something, you would know, you'd be able to figure out approximately how much it's going to cost you. And possibly putting a device into the car, which they can do. The technology is here to do this, that tells where you are, at what time of the day, and it even tells how fast you're going. So the system could also be used to issue speeding tickets if people are going too fast, or possibly even at some point, and I know that a lot of drivers will love this, at some point, the system could not allow the car to go over a certain speed in certain areas. And variable speed limits, depending on the time of day, and the congestion level and how many children are present and so forth, could be all implemented and put into this system. And this information would be fed to the driver. Most new cars have a little TV screen in there, and they can give you messages there. They could even give verbal messages. The other thing is Chuck said that the employer should pay for an employee to get to work. I disagree with this. The employee makes at least half the decision of where he's going to work. The employer makes half the decision. The employer says yes, and the employee says yes. The employee has made a decision to where he's going to work. And he's also made a decision to where he's going to live. And if he wants to a good job in the city, but he wants to live in a nice rural, not necessarily a rural area, but a less congested and out in the suburbs for whatever reason, fine. But then one of the things that it's going to cost him is how much money he pays to get to and from work and how much time it takes him. So I think the employee is really responsible for most. Of course, an employer will pay if you're driving somewhere on business for your employer, then the employer is going to pay the cost of that. This is how it is now and how it should be in the future. And perhaps employers that want to attract people to come to work for them would, as a benefit, say, we will pay some of your transportation costs. And there was such a system here a while ago. I know I got my CTA passes at a reduced rate and I worked downtown. I don't know if that system is still in effect. The other thing, let me see, that's the employer paying. I had a couple of other points and I'm trying to remember what they are now, where I disagreed with your implementation. And I think the notion that all of this should be free, you should get rid of gas taxes, I think that's a terrible idea. I think that we need to seriously increase gas taxes, if anything, and perhaps allow each individual to get a certain number of gallons of gas at a very low tax per month, but then the rate would go up the more you drive. And perhaps there would be lower rates. This is another thing we could do with a variable computer system like that. People who are lower income would possibly pay a smaller per mile rate for certainly their work driving and any necessary shopping and picking up kids at school and things like this. So I believe that in a few years, very few people will own cars because there'll be services, something like Uber and Lyft, except you'll key in where you are and where you want to go. And a car will come, an automated car without a driver will come and pick you up and take you there. There may be other people in the car. There may be other stops on the way. And so you would not even need to own a car. It would be cheap because right now, when you pay a CTA fare or any other transportation fare, 60 or 70% of that is going to labor. In other words, the engineer or the operator, in most cases, that's most of it. And if there were no human operator, the cost should go way down. Okay. I think a lot of people objected to the fact when they got rid of bank tellers and gave us ATMs. A lot of people didn't like that at first, but now we kind of take it for granted. It's really, you know, not that hard to operate these machines, except they come out with different versions every couple of years and you have to relearn how to use them. But anyway, okay. I think that covers most I'm wanting to bring out. I think we really do need to do something. What we need to do is reduce vehicle miles driven, particularly as long as we're still on fossil fuels. In a few years, we'll be hopefully off of fossil fuels. But while we're on fossil fuels, less vehicle miles driven is less pollution. And the way we reduce vehicle miles driven are through some of the things that Charlie brought up in his plan. And some of the things that I'm setting forth here. In other words, depending on what you're using the vehicle for, there's a different cost to that to motivate people to consolidate trips and not to drive if they don't have to, et cetera, et cetera. All right, I think I'm probably over my time. Am I over my time? Okay. I'm way over my time. All right. Anyway, thank you. I enjoyed the talk, Charlie. I have downloaded your slides. You should let everybody know that you're going to have your slides. Your slides are on the internet now. or they're somewhere out there. And so if people want to look through the presentation again, they can.
All right.
Thank you.
We're going to LA next. And then, we're going to Mike next here at Dapper's. Then we're going to Elaine. And then Kelvin, if you got to say something, I'll put you as his third one down. Go ahead. Go ahead, Mike.
How many point plan was Charlie's plan?
I don't know
how. Yeah, I knew you.
How many? Anyway, maybe try to hear it.
He can't hear you.
Can I hear it?
Talk to both mics.
Okay.
Silver
one. Well, silver one. As you guys know. Okay.
Go ahead, Mike.
As you guys probably know, I'm a transportation geek. You know, Metro, Amtrak, CTA Rail, all that kind of stuff, bullet trains. Now I've turned into a CTA bus geek the last several years, and I really like buses now. And I turned into a tram geek in Europe. So, you could take for $2.25, you could take 3 trips on a bus in Chicago and within 2 hours. It's really sweet. I can go here to Dapper's, get a bite to eat, and go away at home. Anyway, I think real bicycle riders are four seasons, not just warm weather crap. I was minimum 3 seasons. So anyway, I believe the future will be not Teslas and all that kind of stuff, because I don't think there's too many issues. If you think Tesla has problems, just look at their missile that blew off the other night. Anyway, so after visiting Europe recently, dedicated, protected bike EV, small EV lanes are the future. No question. I saw it a lot in Europe. All the trends in America start in Europe first, of course. And you could have electric wheelchairs. You could have electric bikes. You could have electric scooters. You could have electric skateboards. All kinds. I even saw an electric EV, small EV store opening in Chicago. The kids love that stuff because you don't have to deal with the issues with these big, ugly parking lots and everything else with the big ass cars. So, yeah, it's a good idea to get off the car. You're going to get fat asses burning lots of gases. So, but I really think the future is going to be, we're not taking away your cars, but we're going to really, really support bicycle, small EV lanes. They have to be everywhere. They have to be dedicated. They have to be safe. They even should be plowed in the winter. Jonathan, for you wimpy guys that are afraid of a little snow, or put canopies on them. The canopy is probably a little expensive.
Okay.
So, sorry, Charlie, you should have looked into bike lanes and EV lanes.
Not everyone can use a bike.
True, but you can have an electric wheelchair if you can't get around.
If you can't use it, it's of no value.
All right, let's quit the cost talk. Finish up, Mike.
Not everyone can use it. They're denied a mode of transit.
Not everybody could drive a car. In fact, half of the country doesn't drive a car because
they can't. Well, nobody wants bikes. They're dangerous.
I don't even.
And not everyone can use them.
Charlie, would
I don't even drive a car anymore.
One fool at a time, Charlie.
Thank you, David.
It's not. If the community can't use it, we don't want it.
All right. All right, if the community can't use it, he doesn't want it. All right, Charlie, you'll get the last word, Charlie, as the speaker. Elaine, you're next, please. Elaine, you're next.
The community can't use it. No.
Charlie,
Over your 5-point plan again. I missed some of it.
All right, Elaine, go ahead.
I like your idea. Right, I guess.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Elaine.
Thank you for I'm speaking. Can y'all hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great. Thank you for the presentation.
Thank
Okay, go ahead, Elaine. We were waiting for you. We're waiting for you.
Okay. Thank you for the presentation. One thing I think you it would have been great for y'all to cover would have been the 15-minute city plan. The UN development plan where they will reorient cities to be walkable. And that would eliminate the necessity for a car for most people. That's probably like the big thing other than just saying cars aren't allowed anymore. That said, I massively disagree with you about bicycles. Bicycles are amazing. Yeah, not everyone can use them. So, but for the people that can use them, they're great.
And they're a danger to pedestrians.
Charlie, shut up!
Out of time, Charlie. That sounds beautiful.
You just sing the national anthem. All right, go ahead.
I ride my bicycle down here in Houston, and I'm fine. They're not that dangerous. And down here, everyone is an idiot in the truck. And I still somehow am alive, so anecdotal, but still. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I want just that short point. Thanks for hearing me.
Thank you.
All right, Jake, you're next, and then Andy.
For endangering us.
I'm not opposed to bicycles, but they're not universally available. Some people can ride them, and some people can't. Plus, it's kind of a cumbersome mode of transportation to get to and from work for most people. I got a question here. If you're going to impose congestion taxes, how do you enforce it? The congestion pricing, I mean. How do you enforce it?
I can answer that.
This is rebuttal time, correct?
This is a question to a previous rebuttal. If you want to wait, you can answer it later. I'm talking specifically about to Ernie.
If you want an answer, I can give you it.
Well, this is a rebuttal time, so this is where we don't ask other people questions.
I'm asking a question. I'm just saying if you're imposed congestion taxes, and you have to have a way of enforcing it, otherwise it doesn't really mean anything.
There are a variety of ways.
One at a time.
To look at license plates with TV cameras.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah.
Hey, I'd be opposed to that because it's intrusive. Anyway,
right,
can I finish, please? I support better public transit, but I don't think just throwing money at the problem is going to solve the problem. Here in Chicago is just a prime example. You can throw all the money you want at the CTA, and it's not going to improve quality of service. You need people at the top who really know what they're doing. Otherwise, it's not going to really mean anything.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Andy, you want to go? Go ahead.
Yeah.
You're up, Andy.
Okay. Two observations. Number one.
Can't hear you.
What is he knowing about?
He said he can't hear you. Just talk.
How come I'm the only one he can't hear? He interrupts me all the time. Nobody else. It's always, he can't hear me.
Okay.
The problem with everybody, Andy.
All right,
is
now.
That Justin speaking?
That's better.
All right, okay, can you hear me now, everybody?
Yes.
Better.
Yeah, it's better. Better.
In
1977 to 79, that general area, there were houses without furnaces built in Germany, all across Europe. That's how long they've known that houses don't need furnaces, and you can heat them for $10 a month worth of energy. In 1980, they started making 100 mile per gallon cars. A Volkswagen had a 100 mile per gallon car that would go coast to coast on 130-gallon tank of gas. High mileage cars are not produced in America and not for sale in America. They were said, well, I think one company produces, it might be Ford, it gets 38 miles a gallon here and it gets 75 miles a gallon in Germany. But you can't buy one over there and bring it here. High mileage cars are kept off the roads of America because they want our donation. every month, every week in fossil fuel. Bringing the troops home, number three, bringing the troops home from the 800 bases around the world and draw a 200-mile radius around America and let the military defend that, like the famous General Smedley Butler said, that would save $500 billion a year, $500 billion. Universal health care and nonprofit education, like what we had during Eisenhower years, we virtually had almost universal health care in this country. It was nonprofit, it was cheap, affordable. You didn't have to bankrupt yourself to go to the hospital to get treatment or something, emergency room. That could save another $500 billion a year to go pay for everything that Charlie's talking about tonight. These things would provide enough savings to convert over to green non-fossil fuel energy within the next 15 to 20 years in America. Probably do it, as Avery Lovin says, we can get there, we can get to half within a decade by 2030 with just cost-effective things, not even talking about what I'm talking about here. For affordable electric cars and electric bikes. You can buy an electric bike now at Costco for $600-$800 or something. They come, a lot of people have bad knees. They can't pedal a bike, but electric bikes are a game changer. India is going to elect like pizza delivery and all kinds of other stuff. Delivery vehicles are going to three-wheel electric bikes with interchangeable batteries. It's a total game changer all over the world. So the point I'm making is, why don't we have these things in America? Why doesn't the media talk about these things? Well, we have a billionaire predator problem and a wholly owned intellectual prostitute problem in the media and the Congress. If you're not an intellectual prostitute, you can't be a Republican today, because they will vote you out and replace you with an intellectual prostitute like Marjorie Taylor Greene or somebody else. And bless his heart, Joe Manchin is showing us what a male intellectual prostitute looks like. So until we address that issue, we're not going to get any of this stuff through Congress. And that's why, who heard about the big one happening in the UK? It's advertised all over the internet from around the world. Extinction Rebellion and 100 other environmental groups. Friday starts the big one. The largest peaceful demonstration in the history of the world for climate change. Okay. And they said, last thing, if you want to know what's happening, I brought two books that are summaries of probably 100 other books. This one is called The Climate Book by Greta Thunberg. It's she edited a bunch of articles by experts from all over the world. This one is Michael Mann's new book. It's called The New Climate War. These two are excellent summaries of things that can be done, and also summaries of good things that people already are doing. And so this stuff is not in the mainstream media and news. You have to look at the internets, and anybody wants any other information on this, please feel free to contact me.
We are the mainstream news here.
All right, I'm going to go next.
Can you let them back in?
You sure I should?
Yeah, just Ann comes in a lot. Don't worry, just bring her in.
All right.
As far as I'm concerned, Charlie's plan is what I call a piece of nonsense. It's unworkable. The amount of fraud that would be in through the buying and selling of permits would make a nice job for bringing in another Capone, Al Capone, and instead of selling whiskey, he'd be selling transportation permits. And of course, with the amount of corruption that goes into the economy. Let's talk about something that does work. You know, New York City is a big metropolis. You have a lot of people in there, and it's an area that's and the thing is, just let it go, Jonathan, it's fine. What happens is that we are able to get a lot of people moving on a publicly funded subway system. They also allow cars in, but they also know too that if they're going to drive, they're going to pay a price because they chose the car and have congestion. Many of your urban and rural people do use the subway more because they also know that it's probably one of the most efficient ways to get around. London has congestion pricing, where they limit the amount of vehicles in the downtown area, but it's done through a toll, much like you use your iPass. And that, when you put up a cost of like 10 bucks to drive downtown during the middle of the workday, that usually works, but it also drives away shoppers and other things like that. However, there are such things as parking garages that you can also use. The other thing to do is that if you really want to stop fossil fuels, just tax the gasoline and subsidize the electric. I mean, I don't like the government intervention myself, but the other part of the matter, you want to get off fossil fuels and you really want to do it, you're going to have an equivalent system that provides centrally located massive power. And as I said before, nuclear is going to be the only way we'll get that done, despite what drawbacks they're going to be having with waste and other things like that, which can effectively be managed away, I believe, through the adoption of the liquid fluoride reactor. There are a lot of other things to consider. I mean, you know, if we kind of let the free market go a little bit with this stuff, we might just find that there might be a better solution to this. I mean, you know, taxis, it was hard to get a taxi for a long time. The Uber and Lyft came along. We also now have, other areas of things. And with this automated trucking and everything else, the thing is, you don't want to shut down the economy. And China, believe it or not, has built just as much interstate in the last 20 years as we did under the Eisenhower Act. They've also done a lot of high-speed rail. But that doesn't mean they're not dependent on cars either, because they certainly are. Now, the thing is how are you going to get rid of a lot of the fossil fuels and the consumption? It's simple. Hike the price of gas, build out an electrically good infrastructure, and let's use this improved battery technology to start really making an electric car worth it. Right now, I would not want to drive electric because I'd be afraid to change. Why not do something like just put a small gas generator on the back of the thing to need extended range? It's simple stuff like that that you really get this. And yes, we need help with buildings, with heat, with light. You know, and that'll happen when the price to heat the building is a little bit more expensive. And people will definitely do that to save money. Well, anyway, I've had enough of my soapbox.
Who's going
to
pay for all this infrastructure for electric cars? You?
Privately owned, Charlie. You'll get the
land. Where are you going to put all this infrastructure for electric cars?
Charlie, you
pay for it, not me.
The last word, Charlie. Hold off. All right, Ellen, go ahead.
So 4 minutes, right?
4 minutes.
Yeah, four okay, minutes, yeah. Ellen.
Right, yeah. So, yeah, I'm Ellen Corley, and it occurs to me that I want to speak to not necessarily the subject that Charlie has brought up, because that's what I was told when I came here, that yeah, it's all right. You can speak with what you think needs to be talked about.
Go right ahead.
And to me, the issue of our time, the existential threat to our world is the problem of it's an economic problem of asking, you know, the wrong questions, of letting, we've got to all think like subjective scientists. We have to teach in the schools for each person to be trying to understand the problems at hand and be able to argue constructively, thesis, antithesis, synthesis. You know, the danger that I see now is that there's a technocracy. They've closed the schools. Microsoft puts in a curriculum that they've just made up. And this is kind of what I see Chuck's way or the highway, the top down technocracy idea of that really is like the communism of a Stalinist kind of state. You know, and we have to stop the war on communism in terms of meaning like the Sandinistas, the, you know, the tribes, the individuals that just want to live. That problem is there's an invisible empire, imperialism going on that's waging a totalitarian total war on the world, and with lies and cover-ups using our media. You know, that it's total disinformation, just like in 1984. And it's come out this week with what they're doing to Bobby Kennedy's campaign. He announced that he's running. I wanted to be there. And, you know, the first thing that comes out, actually, I see an email from Charlie, this Daily Coast had sent Charlie a letter saying, give us money so that we can smear Bobby Kennedy's campaign, saying he's a Nazi, an anti-vaccine, dangerous person. I mean, they've got a total media campaign against him, and he's an environmentalist. And I've got 3 years of data showing, and it's coming out now, but it's being suppressed, that the vaccines are lodged in the head, the testes, the ovaries. It's calling, you know, you think you worry about what's going to be like in 5 years. There's not going to be life if we aren't able to have children. You know, these noted scientists say that if you have a daughter and who wants to have a baby, don't have it with a man who's had a vaccine. This is serious. I mean, and it's the conspiracy.
You can't have this
bullshit.
You can't have this on YouTube.
On me. Can you please mute?
We're gonna get thrown off YouTube again.
All I have to do is think this thought, and this paid FBI troll starts going at me. Okay? You know, right? He's paid. He told me when we first came here, I'm not with the FBI, are you? I'm like, no. I said, if you're with the FBI, you must tell us. That's called transparency. You've been COINTELPRO.
Ellen, what does it have to do with transportation? You're off subject.
To make it so that we can't save our lives. We can't teach what needs to be taught. We can't understand what needs to be understood. The curriculum is being dictated by the bureaucratic FBI. And they say, and Charlie's little letter said, well, you can, you know, there's no, it's, First Amendment doesn't apply to social media or the College of Complex. It only applies if you're a government controller of the free speech.
What does it have to do with transportation? You're off subject.
Over this free speech forum that was here for 70 years, and I, you know, they say, oh, Ellen, let him have it. He says he'd sue me if I tried to have the department, the College of Complexes, if we had any voice in what we wanted to talk about, whether there is free speech or if it's all mandated from above by this tyrant that has taken over this thing, abusing his power, the law, the state, to kill us.
Down.
Bobby Kennedy for president, and let's overthrow Charlie's tyranny.
That's a personal attack. It's got to be taken down. YouTube won't allow COVID talk. We'll get thrown off for the third time and permanently thrown out.
I'm up here to make rebuttals, to make a few points of order. First of all, Steve had to come in here just now to tell you to hold down.
You gave a rebuttal. We've only got 15 minutes, man.
Yeah, can I have my rebuttal, please?
This applies to you, too. One pool at a time.
You gave a rebuttal already.
And Charlie,
yeah, my turn, please.
Shut up.
All right, now, Enrique, you're next.
Last point. All right. I'm not Ellen Crowley's biggest fan, but she has the same right that everybody else does here to come up and say it.
You gave a rebuttal already.
Shut up, Charlie.
No. Follow the rules. You told us the rule.
You son of a... No, never mind. No personal attacks.
All right, Enrique. All right, Dave.
It was Mike said ages ago.
Point that everybody else goes to talk about whatever it wants to talk about, regardless of whether it has something to do with it or not.
Okay, Enrique,
all
you're
right,
next.
David for president.
Enrique. Okay. Okay, I'm going to attempt the screen share for the one and only slide that I want to show. I did it a few minutes ago. I think it went through, but here it goes.
Go through, Enrique. Go ahead and put it up. Okay, we don't see it, but
okay.
What we do
okay.
Now.
Am I on?
Yes, you're on.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I want to start by saying that this whole premise of Charlie's talk has to do with Earth Day. Happy Earth Day, America. I got to tell you, Earth Day is a big diversion from what's happening in the rest of the world. I firmly believe this. To get us to lower our lifestyle, whereas the rest of the world is much worse. It's like we're trying to use better light bulbs, we're trying to do electric vehicles, we're trying to take public transportation. But the truth of the matter is our country is nowhere near as bad in terms of the environment, in terms of ecology, than a whole segments of the rest of the world. And if you can all see the slide that I have up, it's like the Congo. You've got children mining cobalt to run our Teslas, to run our electric cars. China, the air pollution in China is horrible. China is the biggest CO2 emitter on the planet, the biggest. India, water is contaminated in India. You will get sick and die if you drink water in India. India is the second biggest CO2 emitter on planet Earth. Then you have Brazil. The rainforests are being destroyed. They're being burned down. Indonesia, you go to the beaches of Indonesia, you got plastic waste. You see the picture there on my slide. And I'll tell you the one that gets me the most. This is the one that really pisses me off. Davos, Switzerland, every year, all these leftist radical billionaires who think they're better than all of us get together. They fly in on their private jets. They eat fine French cuisine. And they're trying to tell us to stop eating meat and to get rid of our cars. That's BS. To use the phrase that Dave, who just spoke a minute ago, used about my presentation 6 weeks ago when he called it horse manure. Well, this whole leftist movement of Earth Day is horse manure. And Charlie, your presentation isn't that much far behind. Charlie, Chuck, your plan is horrible. I'm going to jump ahead to the end of your plan when you ask your magic question. Are you with me or against me? False dilemma. Any high school student who takes a logics class will know that there is a false dilemma about the choice you are presenting. You're not either, if you don't choose your plan, Charlie, you're not against the ecology. You're not against the environment. That is BS. And I think you know that. Okay, Charlie, you make a lot of points in your plan. One of the first ones you make is driving is a privilege granted by the state. That is correct. But it's the individual state that give you driver's license, not the federal government. So there's no reason to make it more restrictive. You seem to think that just because the state gives you the privilege that they have the right to make it more restrictive. Well, you know what? The representatives that make the laws in the individual 50 states still report to the people. And there's no reason to make driving more restrictive. It's a red herring to assume that state governments should do that. Much of your plan relies on collecting personal data more than what's already collected to see where people are doing, to monitor their behavior. And that's really just a bunch of crap. It's like, how much more does the government need to know about it? Governments dictating when people can drive is government intrusion, not fit for a free society. I will not have a bureaucrat tell me when I could drive, where I could drive, what hours I could drive. If I want to drive my V8 gas guzzler at 3 a.m, there's no government bureaucrat that's going to tell me that I can or cannot do it. It's just not going to happen. I don't care what you say, Charlie. It's never going to happen. Governments cannot dictate when people work. And the concept of occupational use only implies that government has control over your life. And the whole idea about authorization must be obtained for any interregional cross-country travel. This is a direct quote from your presentation. You know what that reminds me of? Papers, please, Charlie. Papers, please. Nazi Germany, Soviet Russia. Hell with that. Nobody's going to ask me or tell me I can't. If I want to cross a state line, you have no right to tell me I can't do that. And I'm going to do it in my V8 gas guzzler, whether you like it or not. The government has zero right to know when I go from one end of the country to another. They have no right to know. I'm a private citizen. I'm a free individual. They have no right to know where my car is going and how much gas it's using.
Okay, Enrique, we got to kind of cut you off because we're starting to run out of time.
Okay. Am I out of time? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Nobody's going anywhere.
Can I have my time, please?
You're sitting in your car.
Okay. Firstly, I had a lot of objections about Charlie's plan on the fact that it's government interference. That is forgetting that you already have government interference in transport due to the rather interesting way that America funds its electoral system. You have very, very heavy you've had very, very heavy lobbyists for the automobile industry and the airline industry. That's why, you know, you get big subsidies if you build a new airport outside the city. The transportation has been already been biased towards the automobile and the airline industry. A lot of what you think may be silly ideas that Charlie's got have been implemented in cities all over the world. For example, in Japan, you cannot buy a new, you cannot get a motor vehicle unless you can prove you've got somewhere to park it. And you know, Japan's not exactly an anti-car country, but you've got to prove that you've got somewhere to park it at night. Subsidized public transport is a must for every city. Every city has subsidized public transport. Even the most capitalist city in the world, which was Hong Kong before the changeover, had to have a subsidized public transport system. It couldn't operate otherwise. A lot of cities introduce this because, quite frankly, the city is not functioning as well, very well, because if you go and spend an hour and a half trying to get into the city in your car, but, you know, you want your government to do something about it. And there's things you can do about it. There's rail systems, and there's you're talking about individual things and bicycle lanes. If I go outside of my front door now, I can get on an electric scooter. They're scattered around, and they have little charging stations. All you do is you have an app on your phone, right? And you get the app up, and you get onto an electric scooter, and I can go down a pub on an electric scooter. I can use the bike lanes, which are also bus lanes. Congestion charges using your license plate recognition. You know, you've already got license plate recognition. You think you're driving on the freeway and you're just like free as a bird? They've got those cameras. They can catch you if you're speeding. They can catch you if you're some speed traps or averages throughout a particular area. So if you're going over 70 to that area, you'll get a speeding fine.
All right, Kelvin, we're down to less than 5 minutes. We've got to give Charlie some time to rebut. Jake, you've already had your say, so I'm not going to be entertaining any more. Rebuttals are officially closed. Charlie, you got 5 minutes to close up the presentation.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Enrique, you are totally free to get into a car and sit and go no place. And you call that freedom? Burn gasoline, listen to the radio, read a book, and that's your concept of freedom, to sit in a car and go no place. I'll be eclectic as usual. Regarding a bus station, a lot of transportation companies have been in the real estate business for years, such as the Illinois Central Railroad. So it's not surprising about Greyhound. Regarding airlines, an airplane is a flying gas station. That dispenses particulate matter all over the earth. I don't know, will you get it in your head? We're concerned about domestic flights, which is the highest volume. Mike would know, obviously gotta fly over the ocean. Get it in your head. Domestic air flights are polluting our nation. Got it? Write it down. Will you, David? Number two, railroads were nationalized in World War I. They liked it. It continued even after the war was over for a couple of years. They only decided later on to get rid of it. It worked. Number three, parking is a serious problem. I was going to do a study. I was amazed how many people, I live in the rear flat, use the alley, cars that go up and down the alleys, because people are parking in their garages anytime during the day or night. I said, boy, there's so many cars, they don't use the street because there's no street parking available. This is entirely a localized matter. It has nothing to do with the United States Congress, at least in inception. So I don't know where that came from. I never spoke about the US Congress. Now, Jonathan, you gave us the Universal Declaration. I'd like to know, is there a commandment of the Ten Commandments that said, thou shalt not pollute the earth? Why not? That's right. What's a commandment that makes it a sin to pollute the earth? What happened there? Why is there an omission? Regarding bicycles, I've long-term been a member of America Walks. Bicycles, whether you like it or not, are going to interact with automobiles and pedestrians. They are a hazard both to the pedestrian and the riders. Bob Madden earns a living about people who got in accidents on bikes with cars. The Bicycle Federation even maintains a help service for people who have been injured on bicycles. No, they're not, and they are very selective. If you have a transformation mode available to only a few people, it's gone. Goodbye. I don't want to deal with it. Cars, at no time did I say the United States was going to take over the auto industry. I in fact said you could buy any damn gas guzzling vehicle you wanted, Ernie. Bernie, you don't need to go to a ticket window anymore to buy a ticket.
You gotta be out of here, Charlie.
Wait a minute, I'm almost done in a minute.
We're done now.
There's no reason for per passenger mile. None whatsoever. I'm concerned where the car is. What zone is it in? What zip code? What ward is it in?
Hey, Charlie.
Give me a minute, will you? The employer has been paying at least 10 years the cost of public transit for employees of the federal government and the United States for at least 10 years. No big deal. And if you misuse the thing, they freeze you. Freeze your account, tow your car, put a boot on it. And that's about it.
We're done. We're going to dismiss the college tonight. Thank you, everybody, for attending.
All right.
Sorry about everything else, about some of the things going on tonight, but we're working on it. So thank you very much for attending.
Happy Earth Day, Charlie.
Happy Earth Day, Charlie.
Thank you, Tim.
Yes.
Thank you, Tim.
Thanks, Tim.
Doing an outstanding job here. Okay.